This week at the Internet Cafe, cyber politics, Dole, Clinton, Kemp, Gore. Want to know more? It's all on the web. The Anarchist Party wasn't invited to the debates, but they have a website. And grassroots politics, care about the environment? Here's one website that'll help you get organized. Plus free speech. Can you speak freely and privately on the net? Meet the founder of Cypherpunks. Plus free software, 4 megabytes of cool stuff on our Cyber Blast tonight at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One revolutionary idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. For connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.
Hi, and welcome to the Internet Cafe. I'm Stewart Cheifet, and with me, as usual, are Jane and Andrew. And we're in a new cafe this time. This is the new CyberSmith in Palo Alto, California, right in the heart of the Silicon Valley. It's probably the newest, biggest cyber cafe in the country. It's not officially open yet, as you can probably see around here. You'll probably hear during the course of the show. It opens to the public in a couple of days, but we're giving you kind of a sneak preview of CyberSmith. And we're here talking about politics in the net tonight, which should really be interesting. This is the first presidential election ever in the internet era, so we've got the Clinton Gore website and the Dole Kemp website, and even during the presidential debates, one of the candidates, I guess for the first time ever, closed his summary remarks by plugging his website. Dole said, check us out at dolekemp.org. So the web and politics are for real.
I thought it was also really interesting. Perot wanted to be there, and he couldn't be there. There's a lot of new parties, the Libertarian Party, the Green Party, the New Party, that are actually getting up on the web and making that their forum to get to the people. Tonight we're going to talk to the AK Press. They're actually a group that puts some anarchist-type writings out on the web. We're going to talk to them about some of the sites that they really are interested in, including sites that may have things from old punk bands, may talk some Noam Chomsky-type writings, and also possibly even some white supremacists. So the power of the few is now in the hands of many.
Right. You know, it's also interesting is when I was visiting some of the sites is the power of the web for grassroots activism. I mean, you can go to these websites, not only get information about these political groups, but also participate. Either, you know, respond in a petition, actually send out a fax to an organization that may be doing clear cutting in the forests or what have you. So it's a really phenomenal way to actually get active in the programs.
So it's not only top-down politics, bottom-up politics too.
Exactly.
Well, lots of interesting people as usual here in the Internet Cafe. We'll meet them. We'll see some cool websites. Look at some interesting political news groups. So lots of politics and the web and the net coming up.
So Maureen, tell me a little bit about APC and IGC.
Sure. IGC is the Institute for Global Communications. We're an internet provider that has been around for 10 years before the internet in its current form really even existed, helping activists and their organizations get online and use the internet in their work.
So you're actually a nonprofit service provider, is that right?
That's right. We're still nonprofit after all these years, and get some of our funding from grants and some from the services that we sell, and have a pretty good reputation for helping people do progressive work.
So tell me a little bit more. What do you mean when you talk about progressive work, using service provider type things? What does that mean to a...
Well, we support organizations that are working on issues of peace and social justice and environmental sustainability, providing websites for them, helping them design websites, setting up mailing lists, and using lots of internet publishing tools to help them get their message out.
So in the past, people would have mailing lists and try to get petitions going and those types of things. So now they're basically being able to do that over the internet. Is that right?
Well, there's a tremendous amount going on the web as that's gotten more accessible to people. But there's still a tremendous amount, particularly in international work, that's happening just through email. Mailing lists, people are getting information from sites just by sending email to them. But a lot of the work now is going on in the web, particularly in North America.
So if I visited IGC's homepage, what would I see?
Well, we run 5 different nets, so you would essentially have the choices to go to PeaceNet resources, EcoNet, WomensNet, LaborNet, or ConflictNet. And each of those deal with different issues that people are interested in.
So tell me a little bit about EcoNet. Sounds kind of interesting.
Well, EcoNet actually came about, PeaceNet was the first organization, the first network we ran. EcoNet came about as a result of the Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro in,
right,
I believe, 1992, and brought together environmentalists and people doing both national and global work who wanted to get online, continue the work of the summit when they went back home.
So what's some examples of sort of places that I could go at EcoNet?
Well, there are lots of different organizations that have websites there. One that has a lot of information on it is the Rainforest Action Network, for example.
Okay.
We help them build a website that allows people to both get information about the rainforest campaigns that are going on and also to take part in saving the rainforest, depending on what their level of involvement might be. They can donate funds. We allow them to do fundraising online. They also ran a very successful fax campaign against Mitsubishi, who had logging interests in lots of the rainforests in Central America and Asia. And as a result of people going to the website, sending faxes to the president of Mitsubishi.
Wait, so basically I could be at that website and I could actually send a fax directly to the president?
You can go to a form, you can fill out the form, hit the button, and it'll fax actually to the president of Mitsubishi.
So what was the impact of that kind of a program?
Well, it got a very successful boycott off the ground and caused Mitsubishi to actually respond publicly to people's anger about the rainforest destruction, and they began to divest. As of last year, they divested part of their logging operation in Malaysia. So it had a very clear effect. And at the website, you'll also see there's an area that's called deVries, where you can look at past successful campaigns and how people have participated in them and got results.
You know what was really interesting about the experience for me when I was browsing all of the various sites that were related was the fact that, I guess from my perspective, a lot of the times with these, you know, ecological issues and labor issues and so on and so forth, sometimes I feel a little overwhelmed that these are much bigger than I could possibly even hope to deal with, and I have a tendency to just sort of want to stay in my own little world. But what was really interesting for me was that going to some of these websites, I actually saw a little button that said, what you can do, and so I could actually click that and actually see some of the things, the actions that I could take as an individual and make a difference. So that was a really powerful thing.
It's very exciting for the organizations, because through the internet they're reaching so many more people than they would through traditional media, whether it's sending out newsletters to people or you know, even getting into print media or television. It's much less expensive. They reach a tremendous number of people. And as you say, they draw people into actually working with the organization from a distance.
Right, and it's really powerful. And now one of the other things, you know, a lot of the things are globally focused. Mm-hmm. And I think some of the things that people have told me is that you really need to start at a grassroots level and look in your own backyard. Are there things that I can do in my own neighborhood that will be meaningful to me, that certain things at your website that could help me?
Well, there are various networking projects that we've created on IGC, and one of them that addresses just what you're talking about is the Environmental Justice Networking Project. That grew up in response to the reality that a lot of minority neighborhoods, black and Latino neighborhoods in this country, are disproportionately affected by health hazards and toxic waste. And so that particular project created a database that people can access to find out if in their individual community there are these toxic sites by putting in their zip code. And then, in fact, there's a map that people can look at on the web page and zero in on their community and see what both the organizations are in their area that are working on this issue and whether there are toxic releases.
So I literally can find out what is in my backyard, is what you're saying.
That's
pretty powerful. If I was interested in getting a little bit more information about progressive activism, where would be some other websites that you'd recommend we look at?
Well, of course, I'd suggest you start with the Progressive Directory, which is our homepage. We list many organizations and that are on IGC, but also links to other organizations. You know, you can go across the whole spectrum. You can get election information by going to sites like the Congressional Quarterly site, where you can look up by zip code again what the voting record of your congresspeople are. There are also smaller organizations that are now on the net that maybe did more direct action or street action, like the Guerrilla Girls, which is a feminist group of media artists, have a site where you can download a poster and then blow it up and make a poster on put a poster on your wall. There's lots out there, particularly international news, which is often hard to get in this country. You can find both on the web and through Usenet groups, that type of thing.
That's great, Maureen. Thanks a lot for exploring all of these areas
Sure.
for us. It was super.
Check it out.
Hi, I'm Eric at the Mojo Wire, www.motherjones.com. We're having all sorts of fun over here. Crazy polls, crazy quizzes, crazy fun, and crazy prices. Who would you rather have as president, Liddy Dole, Hillary Clinton? Come up with Bob Dole's new campaign slogan. All sorts of fun, I'm telling you, www.motherjones.com.
What we're doing right now, Eric, we're actually looking at what, I guess, the mailing list you guys run?
Yeah, Cypherpunks mailing list. This is a web archive of it.
So Cypherpunks is not a website. It's just...
Cypherpunks is a mailing list.
A mailing list.
And a name for a group of people that would hang out on that mailing list.
And what is a cypherpunk? What do you guys stand for?
Cypherpunks are cryptography activists. We believe in personal privacy for everybody.
All right, we're talking basically about politics tonight, and politics and the web. And I guess is the theory that for politics, for democracy to work, you need free speech. I mean, First Amendment, those are the first rule. And to you, does free speech have to be anonymous speech then?
It doesn't have to be anonymous, but it should be able to be anonymous when it needs to be anonymous. The idea is that unless you're able to make an anonymous speech act at some point, there are things that people will feel not free to say, things that they might otherwise say which are valuable in discourse, which are unpopular kinds of speech. And it's only unpopular speech that needs protection.
Are we talking public speech or one-on-one speech?
Both. One-on-one speech has more of the aspects of assembly, is that the government initiatives to stamp out confidential speech that no one else can understand, and to anonymous speech, both limit the kind of assembly that you can have online. Public speech is far more like, it has assembly aspects if it's happening through a mailing list, and it has aspects of just plain old freedom of the press and other
things. So there's a sort of new world now of how people are communicating and talking to each other and trying to influence each other in new politics, and that's on the internet. And so there's an argument going on between two sides now. You guys basically say you should be allowed to use a certain kind of encryption to make these kinds of speech private or anonymous, whatever you want it to be. Mm-hmm. But the federal government is saying no. Is that essentially it?
Yeah, they want, the government has this clear policy of access to all plain text, meaning whatever you're saying, they want access to. If it's stored on your hard disk, they want access to it. If it goes over the wire, they want access to it. If you are proxying speech for someone else, they want to know who it is.
All right, now how does that work? I mean, if they're, explain some of the encryption technologies that are available in which the government, how does the government get in then if you have encryption?
Well, they don't if you have good encryption. What they're trying to do is they're trying
to... But they don't want you to have that kind of encryption.
That's right. They don't want you... They acknowledge that you're going to have it if you really want it. So it can't actually stop criminals or terrorists or the people that are actually
after it. Well, and I want to get together a code. I mean, we've
anybody can build a code. What they want to do is they want to make sure that average people don't have access to it. And so the government's policy is far more about routine monitoring of citizenry rather than is about any kind of national security issue.
Now, what's interesting, we're talking politics, and we're in a presidential election now, and the sides seem to be reversed. I mean, you guys think that the Clinton administration, you would think that the liberal guys are really the enemy to what you want to do in protecting speech.
Well, the Clinton administration has been real consistent in trying to abuse the rights of the citizenry to have good cryptography. The Clipper Chip Initiative came out in early 93, shortly after the administration started.
And just explain briefly for people who don't know what the Clipper Chip
is. The Clipper Chip is we get to listen.
So it's an encryption that the government knows how to get into.
That's right. That's right. It's a very simple policy. That's been the government's stance the whole time, is we get to listen.
Okay. Now, on the other hand, I mean, you were telling me Senator Dole on the Republican side is actually more on your side in this.
Yeah, when Dole was still in the Senate before he dropped out to run, there was a thing called the pro-code bill, which Senator Burns from Montana introduced, which was an export liberalization thing, basically getting rid of the only restriction on cryptography that this country has. And Dole was one of the co-sponsors of that bill.
Now, doesn't the government have an argument in fighting terrorism or whatever to occasionally have some need to sort of find out what's going on?
Yeah, I mean, in an ideal world, if they could target just terrorists and read their thing, then that would be okay. But we have a philosophy in this country of innocent until proven guilty, and you can't know someone's a terrorist until after you've done the wiretap. So there's structurally, there's no way for them to be able to do that properly.
All right, there's two issues, it seems, in protecting political speech here. One is to keep it private, which is to use some sort of encryption which the government can't get into. Mm-hmm. The other idea is the sort of anonymous remailing. Explain that one, Eric.
A remailer is an internet service that allows you to send mail to it, and it will resend your mail off to the destination, but strip off the identity of where it came from. It allows you to make anonymous speech on the internet.
Right, now both of these topics are heavily talked about on your mailing list. I've looked through it. What are some of the hot things if one were to go to your mailing list? What are guys talking about? What are the big issues?
Well, the current big one is that the government is trying to refund the digital telephony proposal. Now, this was a law passed a couple of years ago which would require the phone network to become wiretrap friendly, but it didn't get its funding component passed, and they've been trying to pass the funding for the last two sessions. It got amended into this omnibus spending bill, which will certainly pass, and it's trying to get amended out right now. It's this thing which, as the time this show's taping, hasn't happened yet, but by the time the show's happening, almost certainly it will have passed with or without the amendment. So that's one of the hot topics right now.
There's a lot of wild stuff in your mailing list. I mean, this is pretty unmoderated, people screaming at each other.
Yeah,
this is really free speech.
We practice what we preach, and the Cypherpunks forum is just utterly filled with kooks and wackos and good stuff. I mean, it's a cross-section of what real debate is like.
That's interesting. Kooks and wackos and good stuff. I mean, in your mind, they go together sort of in a way, huh?
Well, I mean, if you're going to not restrict speech, you actually have to not restrict speech. And so the mailing list has always had this aspect of this kind of rough and ready sort of environment. It's not for everybody. It's really loud, and people shout a lot, and there's a lot of just, you know, male posturing. But there's a lot of good stuff that happens on it as well.
What's going to happen? Where's it all going to go, you think, with this whole idea of free speech on the net? I mean, who's going to win?
Well, remember, every jurisdiction is a local jurisdiction, and the First Amendment is a local ordinance to the United States. So other jurisdictions are going to figure out that, and they already have for the most part, figured out that, you know, private speech is good for their own countries. And you don't have, there are lots of good cryptography minds that aren't in the United States anymore. So this stuff will happen, and it'll percolate back into the U.S. The U.S. will just be able to delay itself and shoot itself in the foot in terms of cryptography industry.
Yeah, in this era, I mean, no one entity of any sort can control this information. Huh?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, the motto overseas is going to be U.S. government-approved crypto. Can't trust it, don't use it.
Thanks, Eric.
On tonight's Cyber Blast, we're going to send you 8 cool programs. That's right, our Cyber Blast is right now dumping data so fast that we can send you 8 complete files in less than 2 minutes. What you're seeing over here is the actual data coming into your computer right now. We're sending you these programs in the TV signal at about 2 megabytes per minute. Let me tell you what we're sending you. First of all, we're downloading the congressional mailing list, which contains the current email addresses for every senator and representative. Next, we're sending you the official White House website. This includes government agencies, bios of key administration staffers, some political games, and campaign information. We're also sending you the Republican presidential campaign website. It includes detailed information on Bob Dole and Jack Kemp and the latest Republican campaign news. Also, if you're into the history of politics and the federal government, we're now downloading to you a complete copy of the U.S. Constitution. Finally, we're sending you 3 fun files that will give you a lighter perspective of politics. First is a video clip from the movie American President, starring Michael Douglas and Annette Bening. Check it out before you rent the movie. There's also a puzzle game called Mudball from Broder Bund for those of you who enjoy a little mudslinging. And do you know what the Macarena is? It's the hot new dance that you may have seen politicos wiggling to during the Democratic convention in Chicago. If you dig the Macarena, check out the sound clip of the song we're sending you. Now, to download these files this fast, you do need a TV modem. And if you need information on how to use or find a TV modem, just check out the Internet Cafe section of our website at pctv.com. The TV modem is really fast. We're sending this to you at least 15 times faster than you could download these files with a 28.8 telephone modem. So the download is just about complete. Have fun with your 8 new programs. That wraps up this Cyber Blast on the Internet Cafe. I'm Laurie Anderson.
So can you tell me what the AK Press is all about?
Yeah, we're a workers' cooperative whose primary function is we publish and distribute a wide variety of anarchist, anti-authoritarian, and other progressive literature.
What type of information would you consider anarchist?
It runs the gamut from, I guess, probably the most well-known contemporary anarchist figure being Noam Chomsky. So I guess it's from Chomsky back to some hoary old dead heroes of the past. Nestor Makhno, Deruti, and pretty much everyone in between.
Interesting. What would you consider some other interesting anarchist sites that are now on the net?
Well, there's a whole network of anarchist sites. The Portland Anarchist webpage has a searchable database of all the rest of the sites that you can search by topic or by name of the site.
So it's actually like a search engine for anarchists?
It's a search engine for anarchists and for anarchist sites in particular. Mm-hmm. And all the sites are both linked together, and there's a mailing list for the webmasters of those sites so they can coordinate efforts. And recently in Germany, an anarchist website was censored by the German government under kind of some anti-terrorist laws that were designed to fight fascism, and mailing list resulted in having that website be relocated to a site in the United States, so that could be available still.
Ah, so now is that a good thing or is that a bad thing?
Well, in this case it's a good thing, but in general I think that information, getting the information out there,
is a good thing because people can make up their own minds on most issues once they see.
Now, what was the name of this search engine again?
The search engine was the Portland Web.
Okay, so if I was
the Portland Anarchist,
if I was someone who wanted to learn more about anarchist groups or possibly some kind of fringe activities, I would go on there, I would enter a keyword, and what are some of the things that you find on there that you really like?
Well, that particular site is broken down both in terms of just finding other anarchist websites, and also you can get history of anarchism, you can get related texts, you can get other political movements, you can get other left-wing movements, other publications. It's pretty mixed bag. A lot of the kind of the nature of the net is that everything is linked together. And so the anarchism will link to the new party, will link to the Democratic Party, and it all kind of, you get more of a sense of the spectrum that way.
Right. Now, do you feel that the internet is really affecting politics? I mean, we see a lot of control of politics through the television, but, you know, how do you feel the internet is changing some of that, possibly?
The internet can and certainly has been used recently as well as a provider of information, which is there for people who are able to access it or download it. It has actually been used recently as a very effective organizing tool.
For activists.
Recently, the IWW, which is, I guess, a historical old anarchist trade union, used it very effectively in mounting a picket of the border chain of bookstores when one of their members was fired for union organizing, and they used that very effectively
to spread
the message, both to coordinate writing their leaflets and their picket notices, getting them doing press releases and getting that to activists in different parts of the country. So within, I think, literally a matter of 24 hours, they had pickets nationwide. And it was used again in the last couple of years very effectively to publicize the case of the Zapatista rebellion uprising.
And who are the Zapatistas?
In Chiapas, in southern Mexico.
So they're actually Mexican-American Indians that live in the Chiapas region.
Yeah. And
definitely
again,
someone who doesn't usually have access to a mass vehicle for communication.
I'm not even sure that they themselves had direct access to the internet,
right.
But their communiques and their statements were very quickly picked up by people on the net, and again was very widely disseminated.
So this was information that was possibly detailing something that the Mexican government may have been
which would have been keen to suppress, as would all most of the governments and people involved. Their main protest was largely sparked off by NAFTA and the effects that NAFTA was having on the already depressed
economy. So that message went out over the internet, and what happened?
It meant that immediately became widely available and disseminated, and that in turn was downloaded and used by people literally all over the world, which immediately publicized their case and created, in a myriad of ways, public pressures which made it more difficult for them to be ignored.
Right. Now that sounds like a story where something really good happened from the internet. The flip side of that, which I've heard people concerns about, is that possible groups such as white supremacist groups could be using the internet for to spread their message as well. Have you run across any sites like that?
Well, there's certainly neo-Nazi and white supremacist sites on the internet, and you can find them pretty easily. Probably of more concern is the recent upsurge in right-wing fundamentalist Christian political sites, which
now you think that would be more of a concern than
it's more of a concern in that it has a much wider audience, but also, you know, targets people's rights.
But I think the neo-Nazi message is probably a little bit of a stronger, dangerous message.
Well, it's actually closely aligned.
Do you really?
There's several neo-Nazis have links and approving things to say about Pat Buchanan, for example. They don't see themselves as poles apart. And secondly, the Christian right is a lot more insidious. It's more powerful in terms of its money and mainstream backing, and hence its power to actually affect people. I don't want to downplay the threat of neo-Nazis.
So you're saying the neo-Nazi folks are probably possibly less
fringe.
Funded.
People aren't going to pay attention to David Duke.
They don't have the power to ban books or influence school boards or put in local government officials favorable to them.
Right. Interesting. That's an interesting perspective. I think there's a lot of people that may disagree with you on that subject, but very interesting.
Christians, for example.
Exactly.
Fundamentalist Christians. Right.
Hi there, my name is Jerry Hanley, and I'm the Outreach Coordinator for Cannabis Action Network. For the latest information regarding medical marijuana and its uses and all the political activities surrounding it, point your web browser to www.prop215.org. For the latest information of what Cannabis Action Network is doing, go to www.ccnet.com/tilde-caninfo.
Well, we kind of covered the spectrum tonight, from the traditional institutional Democrats and Republicans on the web to your neo-Nazis and your Christian right wing and all that stuff. And you had so much to cover. You were kind of frustrated there because you couldn't get to it all, could you?
I didn't have enough time. There was just so much at those websites that were really exciting. And I think, you know, probably the most compelling thing for me was the fact that I was expecting to get overwhelmed with depressing stuff when, in fact, it was really all about empowerment, the ability to actually make a difference. And talking about the rainforest website, mm-hmm. which is at the EcoNet, and there was actually a site there for kids, and they could actually go and mm-hmm. get information about the rainforest, but they also had a button that says what you can do.
Wow.
And so there's a 12-year-old who can now actually make a difference by taking some action. So that was really, really exciting.
What did you think about the guys you were talking about?
Well, I think it was interesting what Jane was saying about empowering a 12-year-old kid. What I saw on these websites is that the net is really empowering globally activist groups and, on the other hand, possibly sort of fringe groups out there as well. It's giving everybody freedom of the speech, some a little bit scary,
yeah.
but it's out there for everyone.
I had one observation I'd make when I was talking to Eric about their mailing list, which he said is totally unmoderated. So, I mean, there's a lot of, you know, real meat in there, but there's also some silly stuff and some typical sort of online junk that people
Random.
Trade, this kind of yeah. miscellaneous stuff. But at the most moderated site of all, that the Clinton-Gore site and the Dole-Kemp site, if you try to get an answer to one question, go to both those websites, you will get totally different answers. Mm-hmm. It's like watching the debate. Totally different facts are thrown back at you. And so what I'm worried about is the internet, wonderful, free, open, blah, 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 but we're kind of seeing negative advertising that goes into television, just kind of moving over to the web, and we're seeing, you know, people saying bad things about the other side on a website.
It's definitely politics as usual, even on the internet, I think.
And it's buyer beware on the internet,
right.
too. Thanks for joining us tonight. Hope we'll see you again next week here at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One revolutionary idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the internet. For connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.